You know, when I was young in movies, there used to be two things that creeped me out the most, and that was the Wicked Witch from The Wizard of Oz, and in Kingdom of Heaven, that haunting, terrifying church-like choir that plays right here. How are you not scared? I'm scared to go to bed. Well, I figured I'd continue my series of classic reviews, and since we're in quarantine, I can watch all the 3-hour movies that I want, and I'm going to talk about another historical epic in this review, and that is 2005's Kingdom of Heaven, directed by Ridley Scott. And this review might contain minor spoilers, so if you haven't seen Kingdom of Heaven, this is your fair warning, and I'm actually going to talk about the theatrical version and the director's cut in this review. And I'm going to let's talk about the theatrical version first. Orlando Bloom stars as Balian D. Ibelin and goes to Jerusalem to find forgiveness and ends up pledging himself to the Christians to fight Saladin's army in the Holy Land during the Crusades. It takes place in 1184, while also trying to prevent a conspiracy with the Knights Templar. And the only thing I think of when I watch this movie is Assassin's Creed. I mean, Assassin's Creed had to have taken some inspiration from this movie. I mean, this movie takes place in 1184. The first Assassin's Creed game takes place in 1191 during the Crusades in the Holy Land, a war between the Assassins and the Templars. This movie is a war between the Christians and the Muslims, but with the Templars thrown in there, there's got to be inspiration. There had to be somebody who was just like, hey guys, I just saw Kingdom of Heaven, let's go and make a game based on that or inspired by that, and here we go. So yeah, I think Assassin's Creed is really inspired by this movie, but the theatrical cut of Kingdom of Heaven, I think, is okay. The theatrical cut is a bit hollow. There are so many instances of scenes that feel like they're cut short. The movie feels incomplete. There's no actual flow to the movie. The way this movie is structured in the theatrical cut feels more like an action-adventure, sword-and-sandals type movie. We're following Balian throughout the entire movie. He's really the main character. It never feels as grand or as spectacular as a historical epic. The way the movie was meant to be seen as that historical epic. The theatrical version is 2 hours and 24 minutes. 144 minutes of just following Orlando Bloom around in the Holy Land. Nothing really makes sense. His motivation for going to the Holy Land doesn't really make sense. Eva Green's character, Sybilla, she's a really great character, but she's not as good in the theatrical cut because her motivations aren't clear, and that's a huge problem I have with the characters in the theatrical cut of Kingdom of Heaven. Their motivations are not fully understood. They make decisions, and you question immediately why they make those decisions, and it's never explained in the end. There's this one sequence in the theatrical cut where she's talking to her evil husband, and she says something like, "You have my support for the war," or something, and it's just like, why? Like, where did this come from? Now it's because the movie almost portrays her as like this villain all of a sudden, and then at the end we're still supposed to sympathize with her, so it doesn't really make that much sense. Balian's motivations at the beginning don't really make that much sense. There's something going on with a priest at the beginning as well, who's barely in the theatrical cut, and Balian kills him, but we don't really understand why. There's hints of it there. It's more of an action spectacle movie rather than the sweeping, groundbreaking historical drama it was meant to be. And Ridley Scott was so mad at the studio for telling him to trim about 45 minutes off the runtime that he himself has even disowned the theatrical cut. He has gone on to say that the director's cut is the definitive version of the movie and that it should have been released to theaters despite it being 3 hours and 13 minutes or something. It should have been. It really should have been. And with that, I'm going to rate the theatrical cut of Kingdom of Heaven right now. It's got great production value. It's still well directed, but you can tell where the edits are. The character motivations don't make that much sense. Because of those edits, it doesn't flow naturally in from scene to scene. You can tell how much is cut out. And the movie plays more like a sword and sandals action adventure rather than a historical drama. And I'm going to give the theatrical cut of Kingdom of Heaven a C+. Now let's talk about that director's cut. As I mentioned, the theatrical cut was 2 hours and 24 minutes. This director's cut is literally 45 minutes longer. So 190 minutes now. If you watch the roadshow, it is exactly 50 minutes longer because you have an overture and intermission. That's how I watched it the other day, but this wasn't the first time I saw the director's cut. Now, I'm talking about Kingdom of Heaven now, if I haven't stated this right from the get-go. I'm talking about Kingdom of Heaven today because it is the 15th anniversary of this movie, and I feel like this movie doesn't get enough love, especially this director's cut, because this director's cut boosts this movie from being an average movie to this amazing movie that's, like, basically perfect. Just about every added detail into this movie enhances this movie greatly. We get so much more time with that priest at the beginning of the movie, who we learn is Balian's half-brother, and he thought that Balian's wife was like some suicidal maniac, and he literally taunts Balian at the sight of Balian's wife's grave. And Balian just loses it later in the movie when he taunts him even more and kills him. That motivation is completely understood now. It is so much more well realized. Those little extra scenes of plot make so much more sense. And one thing that this movie completely cut out that it shouldn't have, which makes me understand that scene I was talking about with Sibylla earlier, where she agrees to go to war against the Muslims with her husband, the Templar asshole. There is an entire subplot cut from the theatrical cut that makes me understand her motivations more, and that is, she has a son. She also has a brother. This was in the theatrical cut, the whole brother thing. The King Baldwin, who is voiced by Edward Norton, who is really good in the movie, and he actually didn't go credited for the movie because during the movie he's actually behind a mask, so he felt like he should go uncredited for his role in the movie because you don't see his face. But we find out that King Baldwin has leprosy, and this whole subplot involving Sibylla's child, you completely understand why this should have been in the movie. You find out he has leprosy. She can't take it anymore. She euthanizes him to save him from the same pain that her brother suffered. And then that's why she supports her dick husband, the Templar guy. It makes so much more sense. That motivation is a lot more clear. And the natural flow of that whole subplot is weaved so well into the movie and so well placed with the scenes that were already in the theatrical cut that it just enhances the character of Sibylla significantly. Let's talk about some of the characters in this movie. This isn't something I really wanted to talk about with the theatrical cut. This is kind of more of my general thoughts of both cuts from now on, because those are really the huge major changes that enhance the movie greatly. There's some added battle sequences here and there, but the way this movie plays out in the director's cut, you understand why they're going to Carrick's castle. You understand more as to why there's a war between the Christians and the Muslims, and why they're trying to take out Saladin's army, trying to push him back. One strength of this movie, of both cuts, is that it never really portrays one side of the Christians or the Muslims as the bad guys or the good guys. And I think that that is a huge strength to this movie. The actor who plays Saladin, I don't know how you say his name. It's spelled as Saladin. The movie says Salahuddin. I guess I'll call him Salahuddin for the rest of this review, even though I already called him Saladin. The actor that plays Salahuddin is great. He is magnificent in this role, but at the same time, you might disagree with some of the religious aspects of this movie and some of the viewpoints that the other side might have. Let's say if you're a Christian and you don't agree with the viewpoints of the Muslims, you might understand a little bit where they're coming from with Saladin and Balian talking to each other in some sequences in this movie. Just the conversations that they're having. it really doesn't portray Salah Hadin as this crazy maniacal villain who's just the most evil person ever. It's very level-headed, and that's something I really appreciate. You don't agree with Salah Hadin at some points, but then you understand where he's coming from at some points. You don't agree with the Christians at some points, but then you understand where they're coming from at some points. That's what makes this movie really good. And instead of portraying Salah Hadin as the main antagonist, they take the Templar guy there, Guy de Lusignan, I don't know, some French name, Guy de Lusignan, something like that. I don't know. They take him, they import him into this plot and turn him into the main villain. Basically wants the two religions to go to war, and he wants all the power in the kingdom. He wants to become king, and he just wants everybody to support him. What an asshole dick. That's all I gotta say about this guy. Every time he's on screen, you're just like, somebody grab this guy by the neck and kill him already. That's how much you hate this little weasel. He is a little pipsqueak. He's also the bad guy in XXX. Yeah, automatic. He's a bad guy in everything. That's all you gotta know. Eva Green is really good as Sybilla in this movie. Edward Norton, as I've already stated, he plays King Baldwin. He's really good for being just somebody who has to provide a voice, who probably actually was there in full costume and full makeup and all that, hiding behind a mask the whole time. He does a really good job. Brendan Gleeson is in this movie. Liam Neeson is in this movie. Jeremy Irons is in this movie. This movie has an ensemble, and everybody does great. As I said, Orlando Bloom is in this movie, and Orlando Bloom is fine as Bailey. And there's the thing with Orlando Bloom is if you need him to be that serviceable dude, he could be that serviceable dude. He was in everything from 2001 to 2007, then he fell off the face of the earth, transferred his fame over to Sam Worthington, who was in everything from 2009 to 2012, and then he transferred all of his fame over to Jai Courtney, unfortunately, who was in everything from like 2013 to 2013. That's how much I forgot about Jai Courtney, honestly.
Ladies, don't lie here. When you heard that this scene was in the movie, you all flocked to the movie theater and went goo goo gaga over that. There's no denying it. Just admit it.
So yeah, Orlando Bloom was the most popular man in Hollywood, and I mean, coming off of Pirates of the Caribbean and coming off Troy, I think a lot of people kind of overlooked Orlando Bloom in this movie. It'd be like, a really weak wuss from Troy is gonna be in another historical epic, like, why? And his performance actually did receive polarized responses from critics, and like I said, he's fine, but I think maybe that's what the character was going for, because he's a man of few words. Balian isn't the bronze, he's the brains behind the operation. And the director's cut, the way it moves, doesn't really portray anybody as a main character, whereas the theatrical cut made you follow along with Balian a lot more to try and get you to care for him. But Orlando Bloom actually plays it fine. And every time I watch this movie, back in the day before that Prince of Persia movie was made with Jake Gyllenhaal, I always wanted Orlando Bloom to be the Prince of Persia because he looks exactly like him. So yeah, Orlando Bloom's fine. He has that one expression on his face the whole time. He doesn't really show emotion, doesn't really act through his emotions. He's a lot more reserved, he's a lot more subdued in this movie. You could tell that Balian was a dude who was more of a forward thinker rather than some like guy who would go into battle wielding a sword and shield, even though he does do that in this movie. But like I've said, if you haven't seen Kingdom of Heaven, definitely do not watch the theatrical cut. The theatrical cut feels really hollow compared to the director's cut, which feels very complete. It's the definitive version of the movie. Everything that was cut should have been in the theatrical cut of the movie. This improves the movie greatly. And the movie as a whole, I'm glad that it doesn't really take one side in this religious conflict. This is a historical epic, a sweeping epic that is supposed to be showing you a religious conflict from both sides. The fact that in the Holy Land that there was war between religions, and it's still relevant to today. Oh my God, how relevant is this to today with everything that goes on in the Middle East, with everything that goes on even in our own country? It's just proof that the holy wars are just going to be fought forever. You can't win on religion, and the movie does a very good examination, the director's cut at least, of showcasing a sweeping historical epic that examines that religious conflict. So now I'm going to rate the director's cut, and I'm going to give the Kingdom of Heaven director's cut an A+. Even with me giving that C+ to the theatrical cut, I still think it is a bit unnoticed, to be honest. It didn't really do that well at the box office, and I guarantee you that's because a lot of critics came out of that first screening and were like, it feels really hollow. But I think it should have done a lot better than it did. I mean, you had Troy, which was 20 minutes longer the year before, and that did pretty good at the box office. It's just, it's the way it was marketed, I think. And like I said, if you're going to watch one cut of this movie, the director's cut is the way to go. Don't even bother with the theatrical cut. It feels empty. It feels hollow. It feels shallow. It's portrayed as this action-adventure spectacle in the Holy Land rather than a sweeping historical epic. So that is my anniversary review of Kingdom of Heaven. Go and watch Kingdom of Heaven. I think Kingdom of Heaven will definitely allow you to see both sides of the conflict. I remember there's going to be those religious groups out there that are like,
this is historically inaccurate. This didn't happen. This is doing this and this. And that. Like,
who cares? I don't really look at historical inaccuracies when I'm watching a movie, unless if it's blatantly obvious. I'm just here to watch a movie, for Christ's sake. So yeah, definitely watch the Kingdom of Heaven director's cut. And I want to know what you guys did think of the Kingdom of Heaven director's cut. And if you have seen the theatrical cut and the director's cut, which version of the movie do you prefer? I have a feeling a lot of people are going to say they prefer the theatrical cut because it's about an hour shorter, which I don't really like. Trust me, if you think that 3 hours and 10 minutes of a director's cut is hard to get through, there's so much that goes on in this movie that it never feels like it's 3 hours and 10 minutes. It literally feels like it's probably 2.5, maybe 2:45. So again, that is my review of Kingdom of Heaven, both the theatrical and director's cut. Drop me some feedback in the comment section below. I will leave my link to my website in the description below as well. You guys are the best. Thank you for watching. My name is Alex Madden, and I'll see you at the movies somewhere.